In the name of Christ, God's grace, mercy, and peace be with you. Very warm welcome to you to our service this day, this all-age service, which is our slightly simpler service. Good to welcome you here, a real joy. Although we continue in what is called ordinary time as the season in the Church of England, we always say, every time is extraordinary time in the hands of God. And so we pray that God will minister to you, heart, mind, body, and soul, and you will find yourselves fed in this service in which the theme is the bread of life.
We come to God as one from whom no secrets are hidden to ask for his forgiveness and peace. Christ came in humility to share our lives. Forgive our pride. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ came with good news for all people. Forgive our silence. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ came in love to a world of suffering. Forgive our self-centeredness. Lord, have mercy.
God, in your compassion, bring grace and forgiveness, and for the beauty of heaven, may your love prepare us. Amen. Let us pray. God of constant mercy, who sent your Son to save us, remind us of your goodness, increase your grace within us, that our thankfulness may grow. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Amen. We worship with Christians near and far, living and departed, old and young. God's word is for all of us. May it be a lamp to our feet and a light to our path.
Thank you.
Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John. Jesus said to the crowd, I am the living bread that came down from heaven. Whoever eats of this bread will live forever, and the bread that I will give for the life of the world is my flesh. The Jews then disputed amongst themselves, saying, How can this man give us his flesh to eat? So Jesus said to them, Very truly I tell you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in me. Those who eat my flesh and drink my blood have eternal life, and I will raise them up on the last day. For my flesh is true food, and my blood is true drink. Those who eat my flesh and drink my blood abide in me, and I in them, just as the living Father sent me. And I live because of the Father, so whoever eats me will live because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven, not like that which your ancestors ate, and they died, but the one who eats this bread will live forever. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise be to you, O Christ.
Heavenly Father, as we contemplate your gifts of bread and wine, body and blood, nourish our souls with your grace and presence. Amen. Please do be seated. When I started at Sarum College over 2 years ago, I was made aware and warned about this strange and mystical feature of college life, something called the Sarum Stone. As you will be aware, the city of Salisbury can trace its roots back 1,000 years and beyond, so I naturally wondered, what might this be? Is it some ancient and mystical Middle Age tradition where trainees are made to sit upon a stone and recite the Book of Revelation from memory? Or might we have to hold a rock above our heads for 10 minutes whilst we contemplate our calling? Or could it be we're expected to carry a large boulder across the college threshold while singing Rock of Ages? What can this mystical Sarum Stone be, I wondered. Well, I can tell you, it was none of these. It was far more prosaic and something which I really did not need. You see, the Sarum Stone is a warning or a comment on the quantity of food at Sarum College, leading to most students putting on a stone within the first year. The Sarum Stone, as it had become to be called. Yes, the figure you see before me, ladies and gentlemen, can be entirely blamed upon 2 years at Theological College, and that is the story I'm sticking to. So, imagine my delight when I arrived at St. John's, all revved up, ready to get stuck into ministerial life, ready to lose that stone or more, only to discover that this place, like Sarum College, runs on food. You know it, ladies and gents. From welcome lunches to church breakfast, from golf course fine dining to cakes and biscuits, those entering these hallowed doors should be made aware of the St. John's stone. Now, don't get me wrong, I am not complaining. Social events are absolutely critical to mission and ministry. It is where we truly get to know people, and especially if it is over a shared meal. And this is something that Jesus knew all too well. He knew that food was not only for the body, but also for the soul and the spirit. During his first few years of ministry, I have counted that Jesus ate with others on no less than 10 occasions. There was the wedding at Cana, eating with tax collectors in Matthew's house, eating with Simon the Pharisee in the Pharisee's house, the feeding of the 5,000, the feeding of the 4,000. By the way, the counting of the both could not be considered inclusive, as they didn't include women and children in those numbers, meaning there was probably 3 or 4 times that number. Then there was the meal at Mary and Martha's house, the meal with Zacchaeus, breaking bread with disciples after his resurrection, breakfast by the Sea of Galilee, and of course, the subject of today's reading, the Last Supper. Of course, there is a certain irony in that our patron saint, John the Baptist, was famous for his, shall we say, eclectic diet. And we can be thankful that we have decided that jam and biscuits can legitimately represent his love of wild honey and locusts. However, there is something in John's and Jesus' love of the simple that should resonate with us today, especially when we consider the food which Jesus chose to represent him, bread. In today's verses, Jesus declares, "I am the living bread that came down from heaven. Whoever eats this bread will live forever. This bread is my flesh, which I give for the life of the world." See here, Jesus invites us to reflect on the simplicity of bread and its deep significance as a means of coming to him, of entering into a relationship with him. Bread is one of the most basic and universal foods. It is simple and made of common ingredients: flour, water, yeast. In its simplicity, bread has sustained countless generations across different cultures and times. It's accessible, nourishing, and essential for life. Just a thought, does that description of bread remind you of anyone? I'll say it again. It's accessible, nourishing, and essential for life. Jesus' choice of bread as a symbol of his presence and his offering to us is deeply meaningful. By using something as simple and as ordinary as bread, Jesus makes himself accessible to all. You know, I love the fact that when we kneel or stand before him and receive his bread, we are all leveled. You can walk through those doors with nothing or with everything, and your earthly status is irrelevant. It doesn't matter who you are or what you have done or what you own. Jesus invites us to come to him, not through elaborate rituals or grand intellectual pursuits, but through the humble act of eating. The simplicity of bread mirrors the simplicity of coming to Christ. It requires only faith and a heart open to receive. The act of eating this bread is not just a physical act either. It's a spiritual one. It is an invitation to partake in the very life of Christ. When we receive the Eucharist, we are receiving Jesus himself, his life, his love, and his grace. And amazingly, the simplicity of the bread does not diminish the mystery of the Eucharist. Rather, it deepens it. In the bread, we encounter a mystery that is both simple and profound, ordinary yet extraordinary. The bread remains bread, yet it becomes so much more. The simplicity of bread reminds us that coming to Christ does not require us to have all the answers or to be perfect. It requires only a humble heart willing to receive what Christ offers. Jesus meets us in the ordinary, in the simple elements of bread and wine, in the daily rhythms of life, in the small acts of love and service. So how can we embrace the simplicity of the bread in our own lives? Well, as a good Anglican, I'll give you three simple points. One, approach the Eucharist with faith and simplicity. When we come to receive, come with a simple and trusting heart. In the humble bread and wine, we receive the fullness of Christ's life and love. Two, see Christ in the ordinary. This simplicity reminds us to see Christ in simple and in ordinary moments, whether in sharing a meal with loved ones, acts of kindness to strangers, or in quiet moments of prayer. Christ is present. And three, live out the Eucharist. The Eucharist is not just something we receive. It is something we are called to live out. Just as Christ gives himself to us in the simple form of bread, we are called to give ourselves to others in simple acts of love and service. As Jesus himself made clear, sharing a meal is deeply profound. It doesn't matter if it's a Michelin star or just a picnic down the park. When we share a meal together, we are sharing in the life that Christ wanted for us. So as we prepare this table in a moment, whether you are ready to receive or not, I ask that you approach it with open hearts, aware of the simplicity of this act and the significance of this place, an action that takes us right back to that simple room in a simple place, an act that was to lead to Jesus' sacrifice and to our redemption. Can there be a more profound moment in our Christian lives? Amen.
Amen indeed to all of that. Knowing that God loves us and longs to feed us and longs to minister to our hearts and minds, let's stand and together declare our faith in God. We believe in God the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named. We believe in God the Son, who lives in our hearts through faith and fills us with his love. We believe in God the Holy Spirit, who strengthens us with power from on high. We believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. As children of a loving God who always listens to our cries, let us pray to our Father in heaven.
Lord, for the years your love has guided and kept us, urged and inspired us, cheered us on our way, sought us, saved us, pardoned and provided. Lord, for the years, we bring our thanks today. Lord, for our world, when we disown and doubt him, loveless in strength, and comfortless in pain, hungry and helpless, lost indeed without him. Lord of the world, we pray that Christ may reign. Lord, for our land, in this our generation, spirits oppressed by pleasure, wealth and care, for young and old, for commonwealth and nation, Lord of our land, be pleased to hear our prayer. And we pray also, Lord, for churches together in Broadstone. We ask for a spirit of unity and a common goal which will strengthen our faith and give power to our combined witness here. We pray for the doctors and nurses in Broadstone and in our hospitals. May they find fulfillment in their work, in their meeting with the patients. We pray they will be able to manage and deal with their workloads in a way that reduces pressure and stress. And we pray for those waiting for appointments, for diagnosis, treatments, or operations. May they have a peace and a calmness in spirit. We bring before you those, Lord, on our prayer list who are not well. And we name before you in our hearts our friends and relations that we know who are not well and need your love and care. We also think of those who care for them and see daily changes of improvement or deterioration. Lord, please strengthen and comfort them. May they know your peace and feel the power of your love surrounding them. We pray for healing in spirit, mind, and body. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We thank you for the fond memories of those who have died recently. Locally, we think of Wiebke Smith, Astrid Hedges, and Coral Wilby. And nationally, we remember the Right Reverend Timothy Dudley Smith, whose words and inspiration will last for generations. And we also remember Martin Small and Patricia Musson, whose year's mind falls at this time. We pray for all who mourn and our missing loved ones. Grant them comfort and peace and an awareness of your presence and your constant love. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for Reverend Helen. We ask for continued wisdom and guidance as she leads us. And we pray for Patrick, Paul, and Gary as he continues his training, the church wardens, and all who serve in this place. And we ask your blessing on them as they serve us. And for all of us this week, inspire us to eat the living bread, to live in Christ, and to allow Christ to live in us, so our actions and decisions will be guided by your Holy Spirit. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Blessed are the peacemakers. They shall be called children of God. We meet in the name of Christ and share his peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Let's offer one another a sign of peace.
Peace be with you.
Thank you.
Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to praise you, Father, Lord of all creation. In your love you made us for yourself. When we turned away, you did not reject us, but came to meet us in your Son. You embraced us as your children and welcomed us to sit and eat with you. In Christ, you shared our life that we might live in him and he in us. He opened his arms of love upon the cross and made for all the perfect sacrifice for sin. On the night he was betrayed, at supper with his friends, he took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His body is the bread of life. At the end of supper, taking the cup of wine, he gave you thanks and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His blood is shed for all. As we proclaim his death and celebrate his rising in glory, send your Holy Spirit that this bread and wine may be to us the body and blood of your dear Son. As we eat and drink these holy gifts, make us one in Christ, our risen Lord. With the whole church throughout the world, we offer you this sacrifice of praise and lift our voices to join the eternal song of heaven. Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body because we all share in one bread. God's holy gifts. For God's holy people, Jesus Christ is holy, Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. body of Christ. Let us pray. God of all mercy, in this Eucharist, you have set aside our sins and given us your healing. Grant that we who are made whole in Christ may bring that healing to this broken world. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. We say together, Lord, we have broken your bread and received your life. By the power of your Spirit, keep us always in your love. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. A few notices as ever today. First of all, thank you to those who came yesterday morning to help clear the two vestries that we have here. 2.5 hours, but we did it. And I've now got a church that is clear and tidy for the first time in about 3 years since the building work began. You could swing lots of cats in there. Not that I do, I'm an animal lover. It's beautiful, there's so much space. So thank you for everyone who gave their time. It was hard work, but we did it. We just got to keep it tidy now. To confirm that the quiet day on the Saturday the 7th of September will go ahead. I was looking at preparing the material yesterday, including me, the sort of 9.5 of us. I said 10 would be a minimum. So it will go ahead. There is still time to sign up for that if you've not been sure about what your movements were and not quite sure whether you'd be able to make the 7th of September. You can sign up. There's plenty of time. There's no limit to that. Just in case you're not quite sure what a quiet day is or what you do with it, between 10 and 3, this space, Northreach, and the parish hall and the church grounds, if it's not raining, will be open to us. There is a theme now that I've had a chance to work on it, not telling the whole story, but telling the wholeness story. And we're going to be thinking about wholeness and salvation, the wholeness we grow into, and what that means for us in our individual lives. So there'll be 3 short little addresses punctuating the day from me, beginning, middle, and towards the end. We'll get to pray together. But there is lots and lots of space for you to do your own thing. So although I will have some reflections and meditations and personal exercises on Bible passages you may want to work through that relate to the addresses I am giving, you may choose to do something else. You may want to come and knit. You may want to come and do a jigsaw in there. You may want to come and read your own book. You may want to go for a walk and then come back at the allotted time for the addresses. And I will also put some books of my own out that you might be interested in having a look at. So you can use that space as you want it. It's a day for you to engage with whatever nurtures your body, your mind, your spirit, and your soul. So please do sign up for that if you think that there might be something you're interested in. And also continue to sign up for house groups, the lists are at the back, and the monthly Getting to Grips with the Gospel session, which will start in October. As you will know, Gary was talking about food a lot in his sermon today. We've got the cream tea this afternoon. So that's at 3 o'clock. I know there's about 80 of us booked in. It is now full, but how fantastic that we've got all of us, so many of us coming. We need a bit of help with that, with anyone who's able, because we've got 13 tables to get out from the parish hall and set up out on the lawn out there, and 80 chairs from the parish hall to get out there and put round. If anyone is able to give us a hand with that immediately after this service, we would be so grateful. And then there'll be 2 more tables to come through from Northreach, but we need to use them for coffee, tea and coffee, first of all. So help us with that if you're able to do so. Gary and Sam are going on well-deserved holiday this coming Friday for a couple of weeks, so you won't see him in church the next 2 weeks. He hasn't run away. We haven't lost him. Up to Scotland, I think, so it'd be lovely. We wish you a really lovely holiday. Back on Sunday, the 8th of September. And 2 tiny other little things. There's an ironing board in the choir vestry. It's amazing what you find when you do a clear out. From the days when, I guess, people did, dare I say, the ironing of clergy robes, no doubt, as well as the altar cloths and things, all in church. Although it's interesting there is no iron. I don't think we need an ironing board in there, because I don't think anyone does any ironing in church. I know I have a lovely, wonderful couple of faithful souls who take them home, wash them and iron them there and bring them back all nicely folded. Please let me know in the next week or two if you think we need to keep the ironing board in the vestry. And if I don't hear from anyone, don't be surprised when a note goes on the weekly news saying we've got an ironing board to give away to anybody who would like an ironing board. And finally, we're always after, speaking of those little cloths that we use something called purificators, which are the little cloths that we use with the chalice when we wipe round. And we can always do with some more. And as we were clearing the vestry, we came up with quite a few of these, which are very lovely, but are the wrong size for purificators. And what we're wondering is if there's any kindly soul or souls here who are good at sewing, who might be able to just take one of the edges in at one side and one of the edges in at another side and embroider a little cross in the middle, and then we've got lots of extra purificators. If you think that you could do that, have a word with me and I'll send you away with some of these. And Keith has told me we've got the template for the large and small purificators online, which he's going to send to me, and I can forward to you or print out and you can pick it up from the office. So if you fancy a job in the summer, like you haven't got enough going on, let me know and we'd be grateful. And I think that's everything. So let's stand and receive God's blessing before our final hymn. May the Father, from whom every family in earth and heaven receives its name, strengthen you with his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen.
Thank you.
Go in peace to love and to serve the Lord.
In the name of Christ.
Amen. Amen.